We added to the backing vocals. Fairly freeform harmonies, but it's unique to reggae music, so they're not frightened of good close harmonies, putting plenty of vocals on. And also harmonies with soul in them, not just sort of formularized, nice parallel pieces. Again, it adds to the feel. It's all stacking up to put that feel together. We put an electric piano on this one. It's another example of when you play the things by themselves, they're fairly meaningless. And when you put it in, what seems like a very twee and ordinary electric piano sound suddenly makes complete sense because it fits into that texture. And we put another guitar on. That was the original guitar. And a beat on the other side. And then you put the electric piano with that. That's the complete rhythm.
That we were set out to do. Kingstown is a place that whatever you do there, as far as talent is concerned, you had to do it to the peak of your performance. So it was a serious responsibility for the Wailers, to the people of these lesser privileged communities. And if it's tough, if cold ground was my bed last night, then that's what I'm going to sing.
Never know what happiness is. Never know what security is. I'm always laughing like a clown.
You had to be tough. Anywhere you got soft, then you are thrown overboard. Yeah, because you're not capable anymore. But the Wailers stayed focused on being tough. So when the weather changes, you know, all we do is apply some more toughness. Yes, there was a time when, you know, the brothers seemed to have gotten soft. That's why they might not be here today physically. A little softness came in. But then again, that sometimes will happen, you know. Samson was a tough one, but he had a soft spot.
Money real love. No smiling, no laughing. Future touch. Only smiling and laughing, but look, serious there. Maybe like a serious smile. And Bob never used to like smile much either, you know, at the time. I sure the mother to me like three pussycat.
The bass line in this is fantastic. The bass line is really what just, you know, pulls you into the track to me, you know. Just play the bass and drum for a bit.
Mm-hmm.
Concrete Jungle, along with Stir It Up, were the two that we probably did the most overdubbing on. But this one in particular, it once again it illustrates the fact that we have this luxury of spreading out into more than just the 8 tracks. I think we pretty well filled up all 16 tracks on this one. But it's particularly distinctive because of the Wayne Perkins playing right on the front of the rock guitar that brings it in.
This was the sound that started the album. It introduced Bob Marley and the Wailers to the world. It could have been a rock song about the start.
And I had this pedal on at the end of the solo, as I recall, which was the sustain pedal from Manny's that I bought in New York. And you hit this thing and it just like held a note forever. It would hold a note for 3 minutes. And it held that one note and would start to feed back in an octave higher. And then 2 octaves higher than that. And when that happened, they tossed it. Blackwater, somebody hit that, Tony hit the echo on that thing. And it just, I mean, it like rang across the whole room. It just sent everybody, it gave me goosebumps. It was one of those magic moments. And then Marley come running out there trying to cram this spliff this long down my throat, just jumping up and down, patting me on the back, going, you know, that's it, man. And I had no idea what he was saying.
And instantly it's recognizable. It has more of an appeal. Again, the radio-friendly thing. It's more acceptable to people that were listening to pop music, rock music, put this music in a mainstream frame. And it's the combination of all the elements, all of the factors that have been put together, the different people's musical styles. The first record came out under the name The Wailers, not Bob Marley and The Wailers. So I really wanted to present them as a black group. And so I wanted to get more of a group sound and more of a kind of a rock sound to it. I wanted to present them like a rock group in a sense. I always felt that this was a girl album. But after the first year, we didn't sell 40,000. Eventually, it sold, you know, well over a million, but it took a long time.
The album's cover says very directly, hey, rock fans, come and buy me. It sort of flattered everybody, really. It flattered the audience. It sort of made it feel like a collector's item, made it feel like a special event. And that's clearly what Chris Blackwell was after. With Catch a Fire, he wanted to make it feel like an event, and an event in rock terms, something bigger than reggae. And here was the music emerging out of one phase into another. It showed musicians in other fields of music that here was a new vocabulary that they could draw from, and new kinds of musical grammar that they could use. I think Catch a Fire had an enormously profound influence by introducing that new flavor to Anglo-American popular music.
Thank you.
relationship was and still is and will always be the same.